All right. Well, I mean, that was a pretty amazing story, I think. And we have another one coming this afternoon that will show you the kind of amazing stories that we're hearing with some of the immune system modulating therapies we're seeing in cancer. And I keep hearing from people, I think Bahija Jalal from MedImmune and AstraZeneca said to me recently that this was, you know, she didn't think this would happen in her lifetime, that we'd have all these approaches. And I'm hearing a lot of optimism that's different from what I've heard before. Rick, I mean, you're involved in this on both sides. You're involved at Illumina in the kind of sequencing we just heard about, but also you helped found a company called Juno Therapeutics on the immunotherapy side. Is this, and you've obviously used to run the NCI, so you've been in cancer a long time. Is this a tipping point? Are things changing? Is that optimism, is this different from 15 years ago when we all got excited about Gleevec?
Well, I think this is part of the, first of all, the answer is yes. This feels to all of us who have been really, you know, both committed to this and overwhelmed by, you know, the challenge of cancer, multiple diseases. But this is part of the story that Gleevec was an early chapter of. And it's not all that different, and it's playing out as many of us hope. It was 20 years ago when I started at the NCI that we sort of announced that we were moving from what we called empiricism to design. That was the theme of that time at the NCI. It's not new. We announced then that cancer was not breast cancer, lung cancer, but had some underlying mechanisms. And as we finally got to read those mechanisms, we were going to switch from this chemotherapy and radiation, which we knew very little about, to targeted therapy. And that's what we're seeing, and this continues to play out. I do think that the last few years, the second great change that's happening is finally the emergence of immunotherapy, as I think almost all of us believe, even some of us, like an immunologist like myself, that was skeptical for many years, we finally have a path. It's going to take a while. It's beginning. We'll talk about it greater, that the immune system can treat, potentially cure, or make cancer into a chronic disease. So I think the optimism is extremely well deserved. But that doesn't mean it's over. We keep, you know, the problem about talking about the war on cancer, it's a terrible metaphor. As we're, you know, maybe not current wars, but we expect there to be a beginning and an end and a surrender. It's many diseases, it's gonna take a while, but I don't think there's any question. We have a path now, as you're seeing with this, the woman who just spoke,
so
towards.
Cancer doesn't surrender. Bob, I mean, you run a company built on this revolution and one of the biggest, most successful biotech companies out there, and you've bet a little bit in this immunotherapy space. What do you think? Is this different or is this?
I think it's a major, major advance in the sense that, you know, Rick was talking about the changes over the last 20 years of really targeted therapy, understanding the molecular underpinning of the cancer or the various cancers and understanding it to subtype it and the progress of cancer, to really attack it in many different ways. So those targeted therapies have been tremendous advances. Now, you know, to really be able to harness our own immune system to attack the cancer in many different ways is an opening of a whole new horizon for us. I do think this kind of session to me is so important because we need to convey the reality that this is the next decade is going to be dramatically exciting in terms of the opportunity for how we're going to transform the treatment of cancer, both from immunotherapy but also from targeted therapies and potentially finding better ways to use conventional therapies also. But the war on cancer, as Rick said, is a different war. It's, in some ways, maybe we will have a silver bullet in the next 10 years, but more likely, in my mind, is we're going to break cancer into so many hundreds of diseases and patient types and be able to find individual, appropriate therapies, if not a cure, to make it a more chronic disease in many, many different subsets of patient types. And that's one of the great revolutions that's going to come. And in some ways, it won't have the tremendous splashy news profile that this has happened, but we're making already great advances as we identify the specific molecular types of cancer.
Sandra, you've worked very closely in developing, in breaking up one particular cancer, in breast cancer, into these, and seeing the kind of results we have there. I mean, what can we learn from that experience as we try to move this to other cancers and to make more headway in breast cancer, too?
Well, I think, you know, I work a lot with HER2-positive breast cancer, which is what you're talking about. In the last, I'd say, 30 years, we've had great advances in that area, but it's taken 30 years, which is great, and it's very positive, and we have a lot of wonderful results. But what I see now, what's so exciting, is it's not taking 30 years. It's much quicker with the ALK inhibitors and different things that are coming out. We're learning, we've learned so much from that experience. There's so much more data that's available to mine. There's so much more innovation that it's much, much quicker. And the other thing that I see, and I treat patients myself all the time, is there's much more hope. So I see that from that angle, that the patients understand that. There's more transparency. They know if you know what an ALK mutation is. They want to know if they have that. And so that's really been a great dialogue, too, with the patients.
Peter, everybody knows you as the guy who talks about how all these things are too expensive. But you also have experience as a doctor and as a person with cancer. I mean, what do you think when you hear these stories and you see all these targeted drugs, immunotherapies? I mean, how do we keep perspective in this?
Yeah, it's, I mean, I think I share the optimism amongst this group, and it has been, you know, I've also been in cancer now for 20 years, and it really is, you know, the old joke was that immunotherapy is the future of cancer treatment and always will be, right? And we finally have this moment where it is it's today. And so I see, you know, a tremendous amount of exciting stuff going on. There's no question that we in oncology have been beaten down over the years such that our version of optimism is the glass being, you know, 5% full or 10% full, because that's the window into progress. And some of these things, including the immunotherapies, are really amazing scientific breakthroughs, but at the end of the day, there's these small groups of patients right now. We haven't figured out how to stack the therapies well. We haven't gotten enough therapies that we're starting to move the needle even on a meaningful fraction of the patients. I think that's coming, but there is. It's true, I'm the one who's always beating on this price drum. You know, it's very hard when these drugs get approved to hear that other shoe dropping, which sometimes thuds, you know, in a way that resonates far beyond the science. You know, the first immunotherapy approved is $120,000 for a treatment course. It's $24,000 out of pocket for a Medicare beneficiary. That equals the median income of a Medicare beneficiary, all in. So it's, you know, you can't look at the one piece of it and then not think, okay, but these incremental or even transformational advances come at enormous personal expense to people afflicted with cancer who have all these other things, right? 5% of patients with cancer going bankrupt due to the cost of their
therapies. Well, Bob, you want to jump in there?
Yeah, man, we could spend, and we should spend days on this topic, because I think the societal issues are profound, and I think putting in the context of, let's take the big picture first, I think ultimately you have to get down to the issue of every drug should be able to demonstrate its value or it shouldn't be reimbursed. I mean, we're fortunate in a position where we have drugs that have nice ratification in German and Canadian and Australian and get very good reimbursement all around the world because you demonstrate a value proposition. So fundamentally, I think we all agree that a drug should demonstrate a value proposition for a patient, for the payer, for the system. How we do that as a society is a very different and important issue. When we think about the challenges that we have in this society, in the United States alone, which is not one of the most rapidly aging populations, we're in a race of the cost of caring for aging people in terms of Alzheimer's, metabolic disease, and cancer is generally a disease of the elderly. A race versus innovation to be able to deal with those causes. In 2040, we will spend in the US $1 trillion to do nothing but institutionalize with the direct care of Alzheimer's patients, not economic productivity loss. If we don't solve these issues of the aging population costs, we will destabilize the economy of all the developed world. We'll have no discretionary spending. That's more than we project to spend on defense spending, well, $550 billion, I guess, this year would be higher. But still, we have a tremendous economic issue here. And if we don't invest in the entire ecosystem of biomedical innovation, we're not going to worry about having to pay for a new drug because there won't be any new drugs. And so we need to increase the funding of the NIH. NCI. We need to make sure that academic medicine and grants are all done rationally, effectively. We need to ensure that there's an adequate pressure on industry to invest in the areas where innovation is needed. But the only funding that industry gets is from the reimbursement of drugs. So it's not like the government's providing Bristol-Myers to say get nivolumab accelerated in different cancers. It's only through the reimbursement of other drugs. And remember, the increased cost of clinical trials, all the studies we have to do, all the safety work, which is all justified, raises the cost of it, and only 2 out of 10 approved drugs ever produce the return that is the cost. So those few drugs that make it, from a point of view of being able to sustain innovation.
But when we're talking about these some of these newer targeted therapies, we're actually talking about much smaller patient populations and much, conceivably, much faster delivery. You look at the crizotinib story, once they figured out what they were looking at, that was a fast story. I mean, Rick, Sandra, are we in a situation where is it conceivable at some point that we're going to have a lot of these targeted agents for targeted therapy and that the figuring out which one to use is actually going to be the innovation we need to figure out how to pay for?
Yes.
I mean, exactly. You're biased on this because you work at the company that makes the machines, but...
Well, but I mean, but the data is very clear that at least this approach of targeted therapy, which is incredibly effective, that part of this new medicine, this genomic-based medicine, to Peter's point, is finally getting to the point where we treat the right patient at the right time with the right drug. You know, 70 to 80% of current cancer therapy probably doesn't do the patient very much good. And that's because we haven't had the right therapies and we haven't been able to choose who should get the right thing. So this new approach to medicine, and there is no question in my mind, independently of being at Illumina, I said this when I was at the NCI. At the NCI, we knew we were gonna have to find this information, but at the time, you gotta remember, we couldn't sequence. Now we can sequence, and we can do genomics. And this is the path to not only an effective medicine, but just a much more cost-efficient approach to medicine. Not the wrong drug to the wrong people with the wrong outcomes at the wrong time, where you only get toxicity and you'll get benefit. This is the big change. It's not just that we can treat more people, we can do it right.
Yeah, but to Peter's point, even in immunotherapy, which we're all excited about, it's still a 20 to 30% monotherapy response rate. And we don't yet know in the whole immunoprofiling the ability to target which of those 20, who are the 20%, depending on specific issues. And so we will eventually get there and be able to that. But today, you know, you heard the latest story. If there's an opportunity for someone who's dying to have access to a drug that's 20, 30% chance is a great breakthrough.
Right, a lot better than.
But we want it to be 100% soon.
But it's 100% better than your chances were previously. Or infinitely better, I guess, actually.
Let me add a third breakthrough besides in cancer that could be bigger than anything we've talked about, which is not targeted therapy, not immunotherapy, but the potential, finally, and it's just a potential, to, particularly for solid tumors, to finally do early detection when we actually know how to cure people. It's called surgery. People do not die of localized cancer. They die of metastatic disseminated cancer. You know, when people think about genomics, they think about, I like to talk about two mythical molecular machines. One is the molecular horoscope. You're going to talk about that later, about what we're at risk for in our lives. But the other, and I think most exciting thing we are beginning to develop, we meaning the whole world, and that is a true molecular stethoscope. That's what we're talking about cancer. But there's a phenomenon that we now know, was actually discovered 70 years ago, that tumors put out at very early stages their DNA into the circulation. We can now measure that with incredible precision, with incredible specificity. And I think, for me, for the first time I've ever seen this mythical great biomarkers, I think one of the biggest breakthroughs we can see in cancer in the next few years is this possibility that there can be a blood test or a urine test that detects early stage cancer. We know you can do it now. with sequencing, not your germline, not what you were born with, but what's in the circulation. And the reality is, if there's a single thing that can change mortality from cancer, change cost and everything, and it's different if you're making drugs, it would be to be able to universally test people for early stage cancer. And I think that's a possibility.
Is Tom Willis out there? You out there, Tom? No? All right, well, if anyone would like to ask a question. Okay, Paul.
Actually, it's a question for Rick for the last comment that you were just making. And it's very exciting as a physician to hear that, but a great deal of concern, the article in the New England Journal of Medicine recently on chorea and thyroid cancer is certainly very disturbing. The concern that there may be a generation of women who've had surgery and chemotherapy, radiation therapy for breast cancer, who some of whom might not have needed this, and prostate cancer similarly. So comments on the risks of screening versus the advantages of screening would be great.
Yeah, I mean, what Paul is referring to is that we actually have been over-diagnosing and over-treating cancer. We're so afraid of the word cancer that, and the best example of this is prostate cancer, which has been massively overdiagnosed to the detriment of men. And some of this is by having bad screening, like PSA. It was, you know, because you couldn't tell whether it was cancer. The standard we have to hold screening to is that you can measure something and it is precisely what you care about. And we'll have to see whether that's possible. But what I can tell you is we can detect in the blood early stage cancer that the person didn't know was there. And because you can measure the whole genome, what is true is that when you look across the entire genome, the changes that are actually cancer that you care about versus precancer that will go away by itself, which is what most prostate cancers, a lot of early breast cancer, we overdiagnose breast cancer, is the goal is to distinguish that. We actually know we can distinguish it molecularly by looking at the DNA. So I think this is the first time we have a technology that can finally address that question of specificity.
Peter, Sandra, I want both of you to comment on that. I mean, is this believable? I mean, or is this another screening trap where we're gonna?
It's probably both, right? And I agree with Rick that we have to do this cautiously, right? What we do know from screening is that we uncover patients who we then treat who are probably unlikely to have ever experienced disease from the thing we've found. And it's not just the ones you've listed, right? Lung cancer is the most prominent example now that, you know, we're taking out people's portions of people's lungs who probably would be unaffected by the small nodules we're finding. But the imaging approach to screening is going to be inadequate in isolation, and the sort of molecular approach or functional imaging approaches, those are things that we really need to look at and use them to come up with algorithms that will make it most likely that we intervene in patients who are least likely to be harmed and most likely that their disease would progress otherwise. But there's also, we have to put against that the toxicities of the treatment. And so we, if you want to think about it, we over-screen for cervical cancer like crazy, right? We over-treat women, but the treatment, although unpleasant, is relatively benign for all the sort of early stage cellular atypias that we treat. And as a result, we've reduced cervical cancer mortality by about 90% in the US. So that's a trade-off we're willing to make. So we also have to get smarter about how we treat these things so the treatment is less toxic. It's all of those pieces together.
Sandra, do you think a patient, if you have a woman with something in her breast and you tell her, well, you know, we did this blood test, this new blood test, and you know, your cancer DNA is kind of pre-cancer, it's not really cancer. Aren't a lot of those women still gonna say, well, I want it out?
Well, I think they will, because there's a lot of emotional aspect to screening, as we all know, and that's a problem for all of us. As physicians, we have that emotional feeling that we need to take it out, we need to do something about it. But with that, we need to educate people. I mean, when we have these good tests, and I agree with Rick, and I know you said this years ago, even when I was at the NCI, that you believe this would happen, that when we have these tests and we know they're accurate, we need, as physicians, to stick with the treatment that would be related to that. If it's a precancer and there's no treatment needed, then that's what we need to do. So I think that we really can do the education. And getting just back to your question, in breast cancer, for example, we recognized this years ago. We knew we were way over-treating early breast cancer. We're still way over-treating. We're not looking at the biology. We never looked at the biology. We gave people chemotherapy. We gave them all the same chemotherapy. Now with the tests, like the Oncotype test, several years ago came out, and we've been able to decrease the number of women who get chemotherapy, which is huge. For me, that's been one of the biggest advances I've seen in my career in taking care of patients, because I know now that I don't need to give them the toxic therapy. I know that endocrine therapy is really going to be of the most benefit. So I see those tests as really fabulous. With DCIS, for example, pre-invasive cancer, I think now we are over-diagnosing those, but we need to know which of those will actually progress to an invasive cancer, and I think that's where the science is important.
Next question.
There we go. So it appears that we're going to be able to detect the molecular fingerprints of an early initiation of cancer. And given the fact that we can't resolve or find a tumor of even 2 or 3 million cells, let alone a tumor that's way younger than that, it sounds like what we're going to do is find the fact that we're all walking around with microcancers. It's almost a certainty. Since cancer is a byproduct of cell division at some point. So it sounds like we're about to head to hell here, where we're going to tell everybody that the molecular fingerprints are, yes, there are tumor sites in your body, B, we have no idea where they are, C, we probably have no reasonable expectation of finding them until they grow to a certain size. So this sounds like a real problem for a collision between science and the public. Would anybody like to comment on that?
I would. You raise a very interesting issue, and it's one that strikes me. I've always been on the side of going after the Congressional Budget Office. That I think they have been one of the great obstructionists to actually funding care in the appropriate way in terms of prevention and wellness. This, though, might be one area where the Congressional Budget Office might have it right in terms of the scoring, that we'll have to prove that to get reimbursement for screening, we're going to have to find the cancer where we are going to be able to detect it and be able to do something about it. Otherwise, there will be no support for government reimbursement of it without that documentation of the direct cost benefit. Now, they obviously don't put in the full economic benefit, which we need to get the Congressional Budget Office straightened out on the static scoring that they do, but it will not get government support for reimbursement unless we can prove that there is a connection between the result and the cost of the initial treatment.
But what if, as a patient or as an over-worried well person, I said, I want that information. I want to know it. It's my biology.
That's why we want to have consumer-driven healthcare. Let people save with pre-tax dollars as best they can, and that's why I'm a big fan of not letting corporations get off the hook. This whole idea of taking corporations out of employer benefit healthcare to me is the most ridiculous thing we do in our society. We want employers to recognize that productive, healthy employees are the best asset, the most important asset they have, and we should be a key part of ensuring a healthy workforce, and so that if we have the evidence that screening is important or people want to make conscious choices about it, we should provide it for them, but we need to have more focus on prevention and wellness and accountability for those results.
Rick, and then I want to get back to
that. Yeah, let me back off from screening for a minute, not, because everyone's saying the same thing. It only makes sense to screen if we actually know it could be of benefit. And I've been a huge both fan of the possibility and an incredible cynic for 25 years about screening for exactly the same reason. But I do think we have the science to suggest we might be able, with the right approach and the right studies, to answer Murray's question. It's really important. But let me step back to this molecular stethoscope for cancer. Because before we do population screening, we have something with this circulating nucleic acid that's much closer. I actually think we are beginning to get data that it works. And that is, how do we know when you give a therapy to a patient, their cancer responds. How do we know whether it really goes away? How do we know after we take out early colon cancer, we've actually gotten it or not? And it turns out the data is beginning to emerge, and we'll have to see, that this molecular stethoscope of measuring that tumor, not whether they might have a tumor, but the actual DNA from the tumor that you know is there that you're treating, that the response to therapy may, compared to the very expensive and very difficult ways we ask, is it working now? And it takes a long time. I think there's a real possibility that this molecular stethoscope will first be used to look to see, did you get it all? Did you actually have the right stage of colorectal cancer so you know you don't have to give therapy? Is the therapy working? And maybe the possibility that we'll know if it's working within days or weeks as opposed to months, and without difficult to interpret, and it's often very difficult to interpret, imaging technologies. So while the extreme of a possibility of changing the mortality of cancer might be from screening, I think this molecular stethoscope of circulating nucleic acids, Patrick talked about circulating tumor cells, it's more circulating free nucleic acids that I think is really where the information is going to be. I think that's really going to change how oncology is practiced.
Can I say something?
Well, I want to see. I want to see if we've got another one here.
Yeah.
Thank you. Is it a block in the road that we can analyze germline DNA, we can analyze tumor DNA, but we may not be accounting for post-translational epigenetic modifications that occur as treatment is ongoing, as people mature, and how are we going to account for that when we talk about this molecular mapping and the integration of that with therapy?
I think the answer to that is very straightforward. When we talk about sequencing, we talk about both DNA sequencing and RNA sequencing, which represents the integral, the manifestation of the epigenetics. And in fact, some very well-known and published cases that have been in the newspapers of targeted therapy didn't come from DNA changes, but RNA changes that represents what you're talking about is the, quote, epigenetics. So this sequencing technology, we talk about genomics, it is both how the genome is expressed as well as how the genome itself has changed.
Peter, you had a comment.
Well, it was a philosophical point, and it gets back to this question, what do we do when we start telling people you have a cancer, we can't find it, we can't treat it, we don't know where it is? And so just to be deeply philosophical at 8:30 in the morning, I actually think the question is based on a false construct that we've all adopted, that there are two populations of humans, sick ones and healthy ones, and that we need to think in this new age that we are all sort of pre-affected and affected. But it's sort of this constellation, and as we talk about prevention and wellness and health promotion, and no one's mentioned people should stop smoking, by the way, so I'll just say it. But we need to think about this in terms of this artificial distinction causing all of these other problems with how we think about health versus sickness care. And Bob, I again agree with him completely. If you want employers to take responsibility for the health of their, might as well, right?
Yeah, I'm, the way. I appreciate it.
So, but if you want employers to, take responsibility for the health of their employees, they need to be aware and they need to be very much in the game of, like, these are people who could get sick and I'm in the business of preventing that because of productivity.
Okay.
Quick question for you guys. It strikes me that what you're describing is very similar to these videos I watch on YouTube of the four-year-olds and the marshmallow test, where they're told, here you're sitting in a room, here's one marshmallow, and if you cannot eat it for 15 minutes, you'll get two marshmallows. And most four-year-olds can't do it. Right, you probably watched
60-year-olds.
Yeah, they're very funny. My favorite one is where the four-year-old picks it up and eats out the inside and then puts it back, thinking that nobody's watching him.
Creative.
Because we essentially can't seem to get a genetic test or an imaging test that might suggest something, and then wait. We just want to act. And I think we're practicing marshmallow medicine. We just can't seem to have the maturity. And I don't think that's just individual doctors. I think the system isn't incentivized for that. In fact, the system is incentivized to act like four-year-olds and to act quickly. You get paid if you do something quickly. You get no payment if you wait. No hospital administrator wants to have their hospital beds empty. Our whole system is set up to practice marshmallow medicine. And so talking about new technologies in the wrong context is going to get us nowhere, it seems like.
That's a great comment. I mean, my five-year-old, though, explained to me that it's totally stupid to wait to get the marshmallow because sitting and looking at that marshmallow is agony. You might as well just eat it and just get one.
But I do think the one hollowing out that marshmallow is a future member of Congress, by the way.
Yeah.
Maybe my understanding is incorrect, but it seems to me with personalized medicine, there'll be, and to treat a single disease, it will require many different drugs. And how then does the regulatory environment have to change to accommodate, you know, every drug essentially will be an orphan drug then, because there'll be, you know, smaller, you know, drugs amounts needed for.
Sandra, do you want to?
Yeah, I think we've seen our FDA be very innovative in the approval recently, for example, in the pertuzumab approval, which is doesn't exactly get to your point, but I'm really hopeful and very excited about working with the FDA. They really want the best things for the patients, too, and the cancer area is what I'm most familiar with. So in the pertuzumab approval, they approved that based on PathCR, which is the absence of tumor in the breast, as the endpoint, and so they did give an approval, which is, was very unusual. And so they are looking at all these different things. We had a meeting about a month ago talking exactly about what you're asking. How do we do these combinations, which we know we're going to have to do in the future? So I feel like the FDA
well, Sandra,
is really...
isn't the problem not the FDA, but how the heck do we do the clinical trials in this world? I mean, how do we get these clinical trials where you're finding all these patients with these rare mutations so that we can treat them?
Well, I think that, you know, you have the basket trials, the umbrella trials now, where you're looking at maybe one cancer that has all sorts of different mutations and looking at the different drugs, or you look at one mutation and all different cancers. So I think it's really, we are totally changing the paradigm of clinical trials. I mean, it's very different. You can have your N of one trials, where one person will be a trial. You have virtual trials. So I think we, as clinical trialists, need to get away from what we've done in the past and these really expensive, as Bob mentioned, trials, treating 90% of patients who don't benefit. So
Bob,
it is multifactorial.
This has to be one of the things that makes you want to scotch sometimes.
Yeah. But I mean, I think these questions are actually related to Greg's question and a question about the subsetting of the patient. I think, first of all, within the construct of the regulatory system we have today, the relationship with the FDA to innovation is extremely constructive and positive, and there is an engagement of really understanding this is the reality. Cancer is going to be hundreds of orphan diseases, and we've got to figure out a way to deal with it. I think the bigger issue that we have to be not concerned about, both optimistic and concerned about, is the data issue here and the technologies that we're developing and the application in the healthcare space to ensure the regulatory environment doesn't stop the information technology revolution to coming to a regulated industry like healthcare. We need to make sure that happens because some of the issues that Greg raised really will become not so important if, in fact, the data is there. And I think one of the issues we all have to be concerned about is we need to accelerate the use of digital health, and both from a cost, values. We need to make transparency more clear so that regulatory decisions can be made. And we were talking earlier off before we came on about drug approvals may come from data that comes from in a post-approval setting as we get new indications because the data is there to say this is the best way to treat this additional subset or different subset or the sequencing of. So the issue that is really we've all been talking about is it's the molecular biology revolution, but it's combined with information technology that will really transform us in everything we do in healthcare. And it's something that we have to be on top of to ensure the regulatory paradigm changes. And there is understanding of that. There's not resistance to it, but we need to provide that framework and to do it.
I think all of this is about completely rethinking how we do what we call clinical trials, as Sandy said. And I think in the end, there's probably no way to do that other than to incorporate what Bob was saying, and to think about trials and the data coming from it as being integrated with practice. You know, there's just not going to be the ability. There's not enough people. There won't be enough trials to do, because all that we've talked about with basket trials is one drug for the right patient, mixing and matching based upon molecular. But we know we're going to have to do combinations. It's just like HIV therapy.
Yeah.
And that then takes it to the nth. And when you do these calculations about how many people it would take to be in clinical trials, it becomes the population of the earth. And so we're going to need to actually figure out how we don't get away from the rigor of clinical trials, but think about new ways to get data and new ways to ask those questions.
This has been a recurring theme here, and you might, some of you have want to think about this, might want to think about it and then ask Glenn DeVries or some of the other speakers in the afternoon about it too, because we'll be thinking about this all day.
I want to echo these points. I mean, there's a couple of things going on. One is the orphan designation and these other sort of traditional regulatory designations don't fit that well any longer, because it gets to molecular therapy or immunotherapy. They cross these conventional disease categorizations. So we need to address that. The way we design clinical trials is based sort of on a Bayesian structure where the priors of success are very low. But in this more targeted environment, the priors are much higher, which means you can actually design things. You can trust observational data more. The FDA has approved a bunch of drugs based on single-arm trials, surrogate endpoints and stuff. The last dozen drugs in oncology were approved through non-conventional pathways. So that's all good news about sort of accepting things gathered in different ways. And we are seeing in oncology the aggregation of clinical data, regular clinical data, at a scale we've never seen before. Right? Flatiron in the private sector, Cancer Link driven by ASCO and some other entities. And we should be able to observe combinations being done in real life, linked to genomic data, and incrementally figure out which things make sense. I do want to say, as a sidelight, since you asked about price earlier, we have a pricing system that will not work in an alternative paradigm. That we can't have, we need a system where we can price drugs based on how they're being used, in which combinations, based on the value they deliver, rather than based on the unit prices of the drugs, or we're going to get into a tangle where we literally can't afford to stack therapies, and we're using drugs ineffectively in one setting, effectively in another, and forced to pay the same price.
Bob, you want to?
Well, just I was really going along very well until the last 10 seconds, but remember, just
in oncology, a 20% success rate's good, so they'll take 80.
We all the issues that Peter highlights are real ones that we have to deal with, but let's make sure that we don't let people sensationalize things inappropriately. The percentage of healthcare spending on cancer overall is the same today as it was in 1960. And in terms of the oncology drugs as a percentage of healthcare spending, it's the same as it was in 1960. So we haven't seen this oncology drug causing in fact, 2012, the amount of total oncology drug spending, I think it was like $29 billion, was less than the offset of genericization of drugs in that year. So we have
but
an issue,
it's also
there's a future
in
issue.
In cases where patients don't have an insurer who pays for all of the cost of a targeted drug, whether it's Revlimid or Gleevec, we certainly do see cases where individuals are suffering financially a great deal because
But I have to, I mean, at least for us, if you're seven times until seven times the poverty level, there's no co-payment of anybody in a system, whether it's through independent third party or if it's not government reimbursement, you can have your own co-payments. The industry provides co-payment assistance to huge populations in terms of the people providing the drug. The problem we have is you got best price mechanism, et cetera, which cause problems that Peter highlights, that we do need solutions to this issue. We cannot have a situation where providers or payers say, it's better that you don't cure this disease, but if you could make it a chronic disease, we could pay $75,000 a year for 25 years. We can't pay. Well, if you cured a cancer, you cured lung cancer, one pill, what would you charge for that pill? We have to come up with a system that says we need to encourage innovation to cure these diseases, and we have to have a system to be able to pay for it, for that accomplishment and that benefit. And we're going to have to come with innovative solutions to it, but we want to cure these diseases, not just pay for them for 25 years. So we have some revolutionary things that need to be done that Peter highlighted.
And that is a perfect spot to end, because now we're going to talk about new ways of changing the way drugs are priced. Thank you very much, everyone. Thanks, guys. This was awesome. And on to the next thing.